It's been 3.5 decades since Ramsay Street BFFs Guy Pearce and Jason Donovan made hearts flutter in double time around the country and the world. Both went on to have massive careers, and Guy was recently back on home soil to shoot a very special series where it all began, right here on Channel 10.
Look, I was wondering if you'd made a decision about the party.
Mike.
I'm sorry, I'm not hassling you. Just you said you'd tell me today.
Well, I've thought about it and I've made up my mind.
And?
I'm going to the party with Shane.
Guy Pearce, can you believe it's been 35 years since we saw you fresh-faced here on Channel 10 in Neighbours?
It was, yeah, well, December the 2nd, 1985, I started shooting on the show, like 3 days after my last HSC exam.
Look, Jane, things change, right? You don't mean for them to happen, they just do.
I mean, my connection with Kylie and Jason particularly, and Annie and Paul Keen and Elaine is so important and so valuable. And I think that we all, as we get older, you know, we respect and we love our friendships even more. And we laugh about the show and we don't laugh about it. We laugh about the fact that we were on it and it was a big part of our lives and that it meant sort of so much to so many people. But it's so great to sort of stay in touch and have made great friends out of it. I mean, the show's just incredible, really, that it's sort of kicked on like this.
Hey, I saw Poppy down at the pub before. She was telling me the amazing news about her and Stamos getting engaged. She can't do that.
Every time I go to London, I see Jason. I mean, most times I'll see Kylie too if she's there. But every time I go, I see Jason and he and I just adore each other. Like, it's really funny. And we still call each other Mike and Scott.
Well, that's so special. We love that you're all still besties.
Australians are lucky to be surrounded by some of the most beautiful beaches and pristine oceans in the world. That connection to the water is a big part of our cultural identity.
Your new series, Advancing Australia, tells the stories of amazing Aussies and their incredible inventions. It has me wondering what I've been doing with my time.
I'm constantly either depressed or inspired. Firstly, because the issues that they're dealing with are sort of so overwhelming sometimes. But of course, these people are just amazing, aren't they? Just come up with some little thing that sort of changes the world. My main concern about invention is that a lot of them just make us lazy. I always feel a bit frustrated when I hear about some new incredible invention, like a car that'll park itself. And I'm like, is that really necessary? Like, I can park a car, you know, like stop forcing me to stop moving. I remember as a kid, when we got our first television that had a remote control on it, I was about 12 and thinking, this is bad news. I'm happy to get up and walk over there and turn the thing.
I think one of the biggest things and what we're trying to provide is the ability to be spontaneous.
It's quite an emotional show. You know, on one level, you are constantly impressed by someone who's invented a rocket that can therefore connect all of us in Australia technologically without us having to sort of piggyback off other countries. But at the same time, you're kind of going, but the person who's doing this is because he's aware that, you know, kids in remote parts of the country can't connect properly. So there's a real emotional drive behind every innovation.
Now that you're a dad to beautiful Monty, he's 4 now, is he?
The other day was 4 and 7 months. It's quite particular. He says, I'm not 4 and 6 months anymore, Papa. So, no, you're 4 and 7 months now, Bubba. So
how has that changed you?
Everything to do with anybody's children now, and I'm naive and sort of ignorant in even admitting this, I suppose, but, you know, the reality of the future is far more palpable now because I have my own child. I say that selfishly, obviously. So I think about that a lot. And I'm obviously also very, very aware of how vulnerable children are. You know, he can ask me a question and I can say this or I can say that. That choice is going to have a huge, you know, clearly I'm always trying to say the right thing and do the right thing and be present and compassionate, etc. But I'm just aware of the vulnerability in a child. He looks at you with these big eyes going, but Papa, what happens if you do this? You know, and you just think, oh my God, you're so easily sort of malleable, I guess, in a way. So I'm really struck and touched by that. Somebody said to me, either when Carice was pregnant or just after Monty was born, I wasn't sure, they said, having a child means you just then, from that moment on, you live with your heart on the outside.
Yeah.
And it's really true. I'm just bursting into tears all the time now.
My weakness is whenever someone wins a whole lot of money on a game show.
Well, that's the thing. It's not,
Yeah.
It's not even just about somebody's tragedy that makes you cry. If I'm telling Monty a story about some wonderful thing that's happened to somebody, it brings me to tears. Mm. So it's quite incredible how his vulnerability, I think, you take on and brings out your own.
When it's spring again, I'll bring again tulips from Amsterdam.
How is it living in Holland? I'm thinking tulips, windmills and clogs.
Well, it's not really my home. I mean, I'm here a lot, but I'm not prepared to call it my home. Australia's still home, and even though I hadn't been there for 2.5 years, so it was way too long to be away, I'm not prepared to give it up. Melbourne is my home. I'll always come back. I'd like to think that we'll actually end up living out there permanently. Obviously, it's important for Carice to stay here in Europe, you know, for work, etc. And I can sort of flit around and work here or in the States or come home and work in Australia. And Monty's just starting school. He's in preschool. And then he'll go into sort of school when he's 5 in September this year, or the end of August this year. So I'm aware that I probably need to be a bit rooted here for some time. But, you know, it is really important for me to stay connected to Australia, to come back to Melbourne, to see my mum, to see my sister, my family, my friends, drive my car.
I hereby christen this budget Barbie camper Priscilla, Queen of the Desert.
Well, after everything you've done, what's the coolest thing that's ever happened to you? I mean, you're a lyric in a Drake song.
Lately, I've been feeling like God Pearce, a memento, I just set the bar.
Yeah, that's fantastic. I mean, clearly, it's because of the film. You know, Memento was really a classic film. But the fact that he mentions my name, it's sort of such an ego sort of moment. You go, that is the coolest thing ever. Like, that is just ridiculous, you know. Well done. I think you nailed it, you know.
I mean,
clearly, having my child and all these, you know, wonderful things in my personal life.
Guy, thanks so much for chatting. It's been so nice to see you.
You too, Ange. Thank you, love. Take care.
Advancing Australia is the most phenomenal series. You'll learn so much. It's on every Saturday at 6 p.m. right here on 10.